Blog Talk Radio.
I have a feeling, it's a feeling I'm concealing, I don't know why. It's just a mental, sentimental alibi. But I adore you so strong for you. Why go on stalling? I am falling. My love is calling. Why be shy? Let's fall in love. Why shouldn't we fall in love? Our hearts are need of it. Let's take a chance. Why be afraid of it? Let's close our eyes and make our own paradise.
Yes, that's what I'm talking about. Let's close our eyes, make our own paradise. Welcome here to The Take with Charles Butler. It is coming up on, 3:30. I got my, no, I don't have a first guest. So we can do a couple of things here, which we are going to do. I'm going to talk a little bit about the Syrian situation, where the Syrian gas has been used. And, of course, our politicians are saber-rattling. You know, why are we trying to be police to the world? When did we get anointed to go out and police the world? You know, it's just amazing that these people are posturing, pontificating. What in God's name does it do for us to jump into the Syrian effort? Well, I'll tell you what it does when we come back. And today we're going to have Bob Muzar on with us, who is a former DEA undercover agent who worked for the cartels, broke up the money laundering rings with the cartels. We're going to have Jeff Steiger on with us from the National Center for Public Policy Research. It's Friday afternoon, beautiful day here in Chicago. I got out, played a little golf today. And hope you had an opportunity to get out and do the same and enjoy this beautiful day. By the way, I was on. I did an interview with Andrea Tenteros today, who the young lady who's on The Five on Fox Network. It was wonderful. She's a tremendous host, and just wanted you to know I'm going to put that up on the website, charles-butler.com. Sometime today or later this weekend. So without any further ado, we will take a short break. We'll be back and start talking about why should we be in Syria and immigration reform. Is that a good thing for Americans? I don't think so.
Hi, I'm Tom Sedaka, President and CEO of Precision Payroll of America. We're the 29-year-old company whose first employee and first client are still working together. With me today is one of my favorite nonprofit clients.
Thanks, Tom. I'm Ray McElroy, chaplain of the Chicago Bears, former NFL defensive back, and founder of the Area Hope on Earth organization. At the heart of success is a hardworking, dedicated team. That's what I found at Precision Payroll. Tom and his team have simplified my payroll, tax, and HR challenges so I can focus all of my energy on the hard work at hand. A Ray of Hope on Earth brings opportunity, empowerment, and hope to scores of children in need. Use my number one play in my playbook and call Precision Payroll of America today.
Thanks, Ray. You're my hero. To join our growing team of winners, call me at 630-242-1507. That's 630-242-1507 or on the web at precisionpayroll.com.
Hi, if you want to know what's going on in the state of Illinois, in the city of Chicago, as well as what's happening in Washington, D.C., please go to championnews.net. That's championnews with two N's, .net. Or you can listen to Champion News Talk Radio every Sunday at 8 a.m. on AM 560 WIND. That's every Sunday at 8 a.m. on AM 560 WIND.
Hi, this is Charles Butler, managing partner of Arisint. We make our clients informed decision makers. Please call us for a year-end tax saving strategy. You can contact us at 312-612-1009 or go to our website, ArisintLLC.com. That's ArisintLLC.com. You need to do that for your family, your business, and yourself. Don't forget to give us a call at 312-612-1009 or go to the website ArisintLLC.com. Thank you.
I live alone and rarely have visitors. So when I slipped and fell in the kitchen last month and couldn't get to a phone, I knew I was in trouble.
Help!
I could barely move.
Help!
I tried calling for help, but no one could hear me. As I lay there, I couldn't help but think of my kids and grandkids having to go on without me. I was terrified. It took 8 hours for my neighbor to find me. It could have been the end of me. That's when I knew I needed Life Alert. With just one press of this button, I'm connected to the Life Alert Center, where I can get the help I need, even when I cannot reach a phone. With Life Alert, I'm never alone.
Call toll-free 1-800-869-0258 for your free Life Alert brochure. That's 1-800-869-0258. Again, 1-800-869-0258. Call for your free Life Alert brochure at 1-800-869-0258.
Forever. You know, we are still talking about the Boston bombing and homegrown terrorists, but let's talk a little bit about all the saber rattling going on in Washington about engaging the Syrians and sending troops to Syria. And, you know, and I hear McCain and these other people talk about we're not going to send troops. We're not going to put boots on the ground. You know, it sounds like Rumsfeld's saber rattling when he, you know, was talking about we're going to have a new military. And this new military will not require us to send troops to put boots on the ground. And we'll have, you know, less weapon systems and we'll have more sophisticated weapon systems. So, and we can do more with those weapon systems than we can boots on the ground, i.e. the drones, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Well, I say this to all of them. We need to stay out of that civil war. You know, I know that when we look back and when we talk about civil wars, you know, you could look at the American Revolution as a civil war, sort of. You know, it was, you know, basically the colonists fighting the British. And if the French hadn't joined that effort, we probably wouldn't have beat the British. However, you know, one of the interesting things that I find when we're talking about the American Revolution, it's always interesting to note how people view history. And I always try to teach my students and my audience that, you know, we were considered terrorists to the British. We were considered rebels to the British. You know, and one of the reasons that's not talked about that the colonists wanted to free themselves from British rule was the British abolished the institution of what? Slavery and they were going to abolish slavery in the colonies. So, can we say that our founding fathers had ulterior motives to freedom when we know they meant freedom for some people and not other people? In fact, slavery was discussed numerous times, and it was a major issue. Let's repeat, a major issue when we talk about the founding of the country, when we talk about the Federalist Conventions, the Federalist Papers, the writing of the Constitution. Slavery was the cornerstone in all of it. Race is still an issue today. And it's a nice segue, actually, into the next topic of illegal immigration. But let me just say this. I don't think, for one iota, that America should enter into this civil war in Syria. If the French or the Brits had sided with the South in our civil war, we might be a United States, a United Northern States of America, and there would be a United Southern States of America, and there might be a United Western States of America, because I doubt seriously if Texas would have wanted to stay in the Southern Confederate Union. And then again, they may have, because at the end of the day, the reason the Mexican-American War was fought, it was fought over white Texans bringing slaves into Texas to pick cotton. Hello. Why isn't that in the history books? Because most Americans don't know history. But Santa Anna was trying to free the slaves. So should we put Santa Anna up there with Abe Lincoln? Well, you know, maybe. Should we put King George up there with Abe Lincoln? Well, maybe. Then what should we do with George Washington? These are all questions that we need to ask ourselves, because they're very complex questions. But today, we have the same question. We have the same policies in effect that discriminate against black Americans. And now we're trying to supplant black Americans with Hispanics, Latinos, whatever you want to call them. But at the end of the day, we have citizens here, America, who are Americans. The majority of these Hispanics, of these illegal immigrants, and we'll just say it's a 12 million number. It's probably more like 17, 18 million, but who's counting? When we look at the fact that only 4 million blacks left the South to come north, and look at the impact on the north in our cities and areas here in the north versus 12 million, we have a problem. There's no wonder we have an unemployment problem. Not only do we have an unemployment problem, we have a problem of people who are here making money, sending money out of this country in the form of remittances. Now, we're tracking, and I need to update these numbers, but as of 2011, last time that I had some great numbers, we had $128 billion leaving our economy a year. $28 billion was going to Mexico, their second largest item on their GDP. First largest item on Mexico's GDP is that $30 billion in American foreign aid. Now, how crazy are these people in Washington, D.C.? That's American money, American taxpayer money they're spending. It's not their money. It's the people's money. There is no such thing as government money. These bureaucrats in Washington, these congressmen and the president, are spending our money as if it's their own treasure chest, their own slush fund, and then want to raise taxes on us. What kind of craziness is this? Do we have a bunch of morons in Washington? I would say yes. These people are not concerned about the American worker. They're not concerned about your future, our future. They're spending money like drunken sailors. I would say they were on drugs, but I don't want to be too far-reaching. However, it is easier to access drugs in Washington than to get a drink. Oh, man. But we have a president who refuses to lead. We have a president who wants to lead from behind. Have you ever heard of from inside the stagecoach, leading from behind? This is a guy, President Obama, who knows nothing about leadership because he's never led. At no time in Barack Obama's career do you ever see this man out front leading, because he's never led. He's always wanted to be a gatherer and a consensus maker. When you're the president, you have to be what? A decider. That's what President Bush said. The presidency means you have to make decisions. So when President Bush said, I am a decider, the mainstream media and those liberal wonks who are the only thing that they know how to write is kumbaya looked at each other and said, well, is decider? Is decider a real word? You could see them looking back and forth at each other in the audience. Did he make another gaffe? Ha ha, hee hee, he's so dumb. No, Bush is not dumb. George Walker Bush is not a dumb man, was not a dumb man. He was portrayed as a buffoon. But he's a very smart man, actually, very pragmatic leader. I tell you one thing. When we had that bombing last week, you wish you had George Bush in the White House. I heard a lot of people say that, Democrat and Republican, liberal and conservative. Those of you who voted for a man you knew nothing about all of a sudden had your doubts, and those doubts are well justified. They're well justified each and every single day. I cannot wait for this interview, to get this copy of this interview that I did with Andrea Tenteros. I'll put it up on the website. It will be interesting. It's about immigration. I am not a proponent of immigration, or can't you tell? If we integrate anyone, I want to integrate people who speak English and who are industrious and who have the ability and capability to do great things. Because, see, once you make these 12 million people Americans, they become lazy like the rest of us. Because guess what? America is a great country. We have a great standard of living. And if you want to work hard, yes, you can work hard. If you don't want to work hard, you don't have to work hard. In fact, a great quote that I love to use is one that one of my favorite Republicans made. And when we come back, I'll tell you who that was and what he said.
Hi, I'm Tom Sedeka, President and CEO of Precision Payroll of America. We're the 27-year-old company whose first employee and first client are still working together. The other day, I received an email from a client that I had to share with my entire team. And I asked our client if he would be willing to share his thoughts with you, and here's what he said.
Hi, my name is Dave Tenson, owner of Tamarack Day Camp and Tamarack Country School. I had heard your advertising on the radio and was both intrigued and skeptical. I mean, how often do things really work as advertised? 2 months into our relationship, I can honestly say that this has been one of the smartest choices I've been made since owning Tamarack. Precision Payroll has delivered on every single promise that has been made and surpassed my expectations in every area. When I have a question, I even get to speak to a real live person. Tom, you have an outstanding organization, and I just wanted to pass along my gratitude, and I look forward to working with Precision Payroll in the years to come.
Thanks, David, for sharing your experience. For great value and even better service, please call me directly at 630-242-1507. That's 630-242-1507, or on the web at precisionpayroll.com.
Hi, I'm Tom Sedeka, President and CEO of Precision Payroll of America. We're the 29-year-old company whose first employee and first client are still working together. With me today is one of my favorite nonprofit clients.
Thanks, Tom. I'm Ray McElroy, chaplain of the Chicago Bears, former NFL defensive back, and founder of the Array of Hope on Earth organization. At the heart of success is a hard-working, dedicated team. That's what I found at Precision Payroll. Tom and his team have simplified my payroll, tax, and HR challenges so I can focus all of my energy on the hard work at hand. Array of Hope on Earth brings opportunity, empowerment, and hope to scores of children in need. Use my number one play in my playbook and call Precision Payroll of America today.
Thanks, Ray. You're my hero. To join our growing team of winners, call me at 630-242-1507. That's 630-242-1507 or on the web at precisionpayroll.com.
Hi, if you want to know what's going on in the state of Illinois, in the city of Chicago, as well as what's happening in Washington, D.C., please go to championnews.net. That's championnews with two N's, .net. Or you can listen to Champion News Talk Radio every Sunday at 8 a.m. on AM 560 WIND. That's every Sunday at 8 a.m. on AM 560 WIND. Don't you just love that song? Yeah, you can see that girl from Ibaneba just walking down that beach. I used to sit with my father and listen to him in the 50s and 60s, listen to this beautiful music of Brazilian jazz. My dad had gone to Brazil while he was in the Navy, and I guess it was one of the few times he felt free, free of the Jim Crow South, where he could walk on any beach and go in any club or any store without being told to go to the back. You know, when I look at these things, I, you know, look at them through a prism of history, and I say that, you know, we in this country have come a long way, and Americans have come a long way, and I thank God that I am an American, and I thank God for America and for all of you. But getting back to hard work and how these illegal people who are here today, we make them citizens, give them amnesty, and then they get lazy too. So we go out and we get what? Another 10 million Hispanics. I'm sorry, folks, but we only have about 30 million blacks in this country. 14 million legal Hispanics in this country. And all of a sudden, we're saying that they're at 43 million people. Well, that only could happen because of all these people being here illegally. They couldn't have those many babies from 1990 till now. Just impossible. So, but hard work. It was Ronald Reagan who made this comment about hard work. He said, it's true. Hard work never killed anybody, but I figured, why take the chance? You have to love that Ronald Reagan. He was a character. Man, hey, if you want to call in, folks, by the way, call in 646-652-2149. That's 646-652-2149. Forgot to give that to you. So if you, want to call in this Friday and share your thoughts with me, I'd be glad, I mean glad, to chat with you. But we're going to have also Mr. Hughey Newsome. He's going to be on with us, and we'll be talking about things that are, uh-oh, something's going on here. Wait. Yeah, we're going to wait. Well, I don't want to kill this page, kill my show here. Something just popped up, bang, you know. That's the internet. It's the internet. I love it. Hey, but as we continue to roll here, I want to talk a little bit about the opening of the museum, the Bush Library. Very touching ceremony, and I'm glad that we were able to view that. I tell you, Mr. Bush is just a great man. Great man. And I think he'll go down in history as being one of the greatest presidents we ever had. Certainly one of the great presidents that the greatest presidents we ever had in a crisis situation. He certainly stepped up to the plate and delivered for us at 9/11. And I can tell you that I was certainly glad that he was in the White House when we needed him. You know, one thing that's interesting that people don't get, the liberals don't get about Bush, is that he's a real guy's guy, a real ladies' man, and a real American. I want you to hear this interview with Dana Carey, his former press assistant, and tell me what you think when we come back.
According to the mayor and police commissioner, they got a very lucky break because the vehicle that these two brothers hijacked up in Boston was low on fuel. They also were...
Yes, it was.
Dana was the soul.
The pleasure of my life. So I have a book, Decision Points, this one right here that's all tagged, yours here. So when President Bush wrote the book, I had the pleasure of doing the book tour and the publicity, and I have a book that looks just like this because it's such an excellent read. And since you guys just read it, I thought I would have President Bush tell a story about, do you remember in the Rose Garden when you said, I'm the decider?
I know the speculation. But I'm the decider.
And the press corps, you know, they would love to look around and say, is that a word? You know, it is a word, and a strong one. And I remember that moment, then not too long after that, when you were thinking about the book and how you would set it up, about 14 decisions, because you said the presidency is a decision-making experience.
Yeah. So I wrote the book as a data point for future historians. And I wrote the book as a way for people to relive many of the decisions I made as president. See, I don't believe you can possibly or accurately judge the record of any administration until there's been enough time so that historians can analyze whether or not the decisions you made are impactful or not. And so I wrote this book as a way to end my presidency, to have a dialogue with interested citizenry, and as a data point for somebody who's going to study my presidency.
When you write in the personnel chapter, so one part of leadership is you've got to pull together a team. What, if as they go into their careers, what's the most important quality you look for in someone that you're going to bring on your team?
Well, when you're putting together a team and you're the head of the team, the first thing is you got to recognize your own limitations. In other words, know what you don't know. A lot of times people, I guess when they get to be powerful, people think they know everything. Otherwise, they wouldn't be powerful, right? Well, you don't, you know. And so step one in putting together a team is recognize your own weaknesses and find people that can fill those weaknesses. Dana did that for me, for example. Secondly is to know the job that for which you're looking for somebody. You got to understand what you expect of the person. In other words, you can't just hire somebody unless you know the assignment that you and the tasks that you want that person to fulfill. So, fully understand the nature of the job. Thirdly, I always liked people who could laugh and smile. I think it's a sign that somebody takes themselves lightly enough to be able to fit into a group of people who's got a common cause?
Most of the people in this room, at this table, were what, you were in first grade when 9/11 happened?
Second
grade. You've grown up in the shadow of 9/11 and the decisions that were put in place afterwards to help keep us safe. And I thought, Mr. President, that you could talk to them about what it was like to try to calm a nation and to figure out a way to protect the country's national security without intruding on the freedoms that we all enjoy. How did you balance that?
Well, the first decision on calm was made in the classroom. I was in a classroom maybe just a little bigger than this, and instead of having two or three TV cameras, there might have been 20. I don't know how many, a lot. It was everywhere you go. You'll see. There's a huge press contingent coming to the opening of the library. And one reason why is our president will be there. And when he travels, there's a lot of cameras. And so the first decision I made after Andy Card whispered in my ear, America's under attack, was to project calm. Because if the leader of an organization in any way shows panic, followers will panic. And in my case, the nation was watching. They weren't watching live, but at some point in time, they're going to want to know how the president react. And my instincts kicked in. I'd had enough experience as governor of Texas to know that. The second thing people wanted to know was they wanted to see resolve. In other words, I resolved at that moment to do everything within my power and within the law to protect the country. It turns out the most important job of the president is to protect the homeland. The country had to see resolve. There's a lot of other issues that we had to deal with, one of which was religious bigotry. In other words, a deep concern of mine is that people would blame people of, the Muslim faith. And so I went to a mosque shortly after 9/11 to send the signal that we cannot lose our values in the midst of human tragedy. Dana's right. We were very careful not to abridge civil liberties. There's a big debate about whether or not, some of the decisions I made abridged civil liberties. In the book, I address those plainly, and people can draw their own conclusion. 9/11 was a very dramatic event. The exhibit in the museum is unbelievably powerful, and it should be. It should be powerful because it's a reminder of some truths, one of which is that
I'm Tom Sedaka, President and CEO of Precision Payroll of America. We're the 29-year-old company whose first employee and first client are still working together. With me today is one of my favorite nonprofit clients.
Thanks, Tom. I'm Ray McElroy, chaplain of the Chicago Bears, former NFL defensive back, and founder of the Area Hope on Earth organization. At the heart of success is a hardworking, dedicated team. That's what I found at Precision Payroll. Tom and his team have simplified my payroll, tax, and HR challenges so I can focus all of my energy on the hard work at hand. A Ray of Hope on Earth brings opportunity, empowerment, and hope to scores of children in need. Use my number one play in my playbook and call Precision Payroll of America today.
Thanks, Ray. You're my hero. To join our growing team of winners, call me at 630-242-1507. That's 630-242-1507 or on the web at precisionpayroll.com.
Hi, if you want to know what's going on in the state of Illinois, in the city of Chicago, as well as what's happening in Washington, D.C., please go to championnews.net. That's championnews with two N's, .net. Or you can listen to Champion News Talk Radio every Sunday at 8 a.m. on AM 560 WIND. That's every Sunday at 8 a.m. on AM 560 WIND.
Hi, this is Charles Butler, managing partner of Arison. We make our clients informed decision makers. Please call us for a year-end tax saving strategy. You can contact us at 312-612-1009 or go to our website, arisonllc.com. That's arisonllc.com. You need to do that for your family, your business, and yourself. Don't forget to give us a call at 312-612-1009 or go to the website ArisonLLC.com. Thank you.
I live alone and rarely have visitors. So when I slipped and fell in the kitchen last month and couldn't get to a phone, I knew I was in trouble.
Help!
I could barely move.
Help!
I tried calling for help, but no one could hear me. As I lay there, I couldn't help but think of my kids and grandkids having to go on without me. I was terrified. It took 8 hours for my neighbor to find me. It could have been the end of me. That's when I knew I needed Life Alert. With just one press of this button, I'm connected to the Life Alert Center, where I can get the help I need, even when I cannot reach a phone. With Life Alert, I'm never alone.
Call toll-free 1-800-869-0258 for your free Life Alert brochure. That's 1-800-869-0258. Again, 1-800-869-0258. Call for your free Life Alert brochure at 1-800-869-0258.
Today, a guest who knows a little bit about snakes, Mr. Bob Muzar, who's a former DEA agent, undercover agent, who broke up the Pablo Escobar money laundering scheme here in the United States, and also exposed the Hezbollah Mexican has talked about that to the American people. Now, this is something that, of course, our politicians don't want to talk about, but here in Chicago, the number one criminal, who took over similar to Al Capone, is a Mexican cartel drug dealer. Welcome, Bob. How are you doing today?
I'm doing great. Thanks for inviting me back.
Why is it that our politicians are trying to act like being involved with Mexico or doing anything with the Mexican government is good for America and it's legitimate for Americans when we know that there's still a great deal of corruption in Mexico, in the government, just in general?
Well, there's absolutely no doubt that, unfortunately, in Mexico, that has been a way of life. I mean, there are quite a few books that have been written. One is called Bordering on Chaos by, I think it's Andreas Oppenheim. He's a Pulitzer Prize winner and wrote that book back in the early 1990s about the nationalization of, not even just talking about drug trafficking, but talking about the nationalization of businesses in Mexico and how in that book they detail how there was a meeting that was held at one of the biggest supporters of then President Salinas' office, and the 25 richest Mexican entrepreneurs were there for the purposes of having solicited from them 75. I've got to go back and see how many millions, but there were millions from each one of them, and in return for that, they were going to be given the opportunity to gobble up the otherwise publicly owned phone companies, the publicly owned various different types of businesses, and given the right to raise the prices as high as they wanted with no objection from the government. So they'd get them.
So is that how Texas Slim got the telephone deal?
Carlos Slim, the wealthiest man on the planet. And yes, in fact, that meeting, Oppenheimer's book, he talks about that's how Carlos Slim got the opportunity to take over the phone company there. And he's now expanded, of course, globally in the telecommunications business. Unfortunately,
but isn't he under some kind of scrutiny or some kind of? He was under some kind of investigation by some government agency here recently. Remember, it was about a month ago.
I don't remember seeing, you know, a U.S. agency.
No, I think it was an international agency.
Oh, okay, yeah. No, I hadn't picked up on that. I do know that there's a lot of questions raised by people who I've spoken with from Mexico about how he's really been able to posture himself to become the richest man in the world. And obviously it's a lot of allegations of impropriety, but and maybe there's something that's been being followed up with regard to that. But you mentioned at the start of our discussion here about the way of life in Mexico. Unfortunately,
right.
Of the 70,000 people who have been killed since 2006 in drug-related massacres, there is a good percentage of them that are good-hearted people who tried to fight the good fight. These are people who are either honest cops, honest politicians, honest businessmen who got in the way of the cartels and therefore were slaughtered. And, you know, if you look at the numbers, there's several hundred Mexican politicians who have been murdered in the last 4 or 5 years by the cartels because of just that. And I know people who run legitimate businesses or attempt to, like houses of exchange, which are just ideal for laundering money, that have gotten visits from the cartel, and basically using the same line that Pablo Escobar made so famous of, you know, you've got a choice of silver or lead. You either take payoffs from us and do our dirty work or we kill you. You know, they sit down with a picture of your granddaughter and say, you know, isn't she a wonderful little girl, and wouldn't it be terrible if she were to get lost? And how about helping us? You know, I don't know about you, but if it was me, I'd either get my family out of there or I'd do whatever it is that they wanted me to do.
Well, you know, at the end of the day, Mexico has always been corrupt. They have been a country of corruption since its existence. I mean, whether, you know, they were under Spanish rule or their own rule, they've always been kind of a country that was, you know, kind of, in corruption. Whether, you know, the Spanish lords were ripping off the Spanish kingdom or whatever.
Well, you can look at the cases that, and this doesn't relate to drugs, but it kind of supports what your argument there is. But Walmart was recently the subject of, and continues to be, a subject of U.S. government investigation and prosecution for violations of the Foreign Corrupt Practices Act. And what they did was they paid literally millions and millions of dollars to different government officials in Mexico in order to be able to get the right to build their stores. They are the biggest employer private industry in Mexico. And,
right.
And they had to, in order to get their stores built, their argument was, you know, and I've heard this from many business people, you know, they had a choice. They could either not do business in Mexico or they had to do it the Mexican way.
Those laws are stupid because, you know, what these politicians, you know, what it reminds me of. The people in Washington, D.C., again, have no idea how the rest of the world functions.
Well, there's no doubt that that is a way of life in many, many parts of the world, in China as well.
Many parts of the world.
Yeah, in
so
China as
at,
well. There's been many, many Foreign Corrupt Practices Act cases.
You look at China, you look at Africa, you look at, Russia. The way they do business is through payoffs and bribes. So we call them bribes. Some people call them payoffs. In America, we would call them what? Finder's fees or transaction fees or, you know, consultant fees. Okay.
Well, they'll give you a great deal on a loan. You know,
yeah,
you get a loan that you don't have to repay.
Yeah. Or I will find a broker for you, and for, you know, brokering this deal, I get X. Now, what's the difference in that? But it just shows you that these people in Washington, D.C. are not business people. It kind of reminds me of that Congresswoman, DeGrette, who claimed she's been trying to get she sponsored a magazine bill, gun magazine bill, and she said once we ban magazines, when they run out of them, There won't be any more high-capacity magazines, and we won't have to worry about them because, you know, they can't. They won't be any more to use. I mean, that's how dumb she is. And,
well, apparently,
you know,
she hasn't experienced the 100,000 gang members in Chicago that are carrying around more weapons and heavy clips than most
military.
But
you know, like I know, the bigger the clip, the more the opportunity for the gun to jam. So, you know, professional, like I know myself, I would rather have a smaller clip. It doesn't take me long to change a clip and do what I have to do, continue to do what I have to do, than to dislodge a jammed shell or cartridge.
Yeah, there's no doubt that you're going to get more jams if you have a bigger one, but that's still, I mean, they're all over the street. There's no doubt about it. They're all over the street. You know, methamphetamine dealers here in Florida, I can tell you, prefer to trade methamphetamine for guns. Those guns are generally, you know, stolen from people, and then those get resold on the streets, and a lot of them include things like, you know, MAC-10 automatic pistols with huge clips on them that put out all kinds of rounds in a very short period of time. So, I mean, I at one time I kind of felt that some sympathy toward the idea of trying to do that, but, you know, as I become more and more involved in these cases and I see the type of weaponry that's out there in the criminal world, it's pretty clear to me that those laws aren't really going to stop the criminal side of gun movements and ammo clips and
no,
body
those,
armor.
You know, we recently had the president of the Cook County the president of the Cook County board put into effect a $25 fee on guns purchased in the county. So all that does is drive people out of the county to buy a gun because law-abiding citizens buy guns at gun stores, not criminals. But that her intent is to keep guns out of the hands of criminals and stop straw buyers. So if I'm a straw buyer, I go to DuPage County, you know, 15 minutes from downtown Chicago, 15 minutes I'm in DuPage County or Will County or Lake County or Indiana. And so instead of, you know, I'm still going to get what I want for the gun, $25 is nothing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, I agree.
You know, but anyway, what is this link, though, between Hezbollah, the terrorist organization in the Middle East, and the cartel, the drug cartels in Mexico?
Yeah, well, there have been a number of cases that have surfaced in the last couple of years. Probably one of the most notable one is a defendant by the name of Juma, J-O-U-M-A-A. So if your listeners Google Juma, J-O-U-M-A-A, and drug trafficking or money laundering, they'll get a copy of the indictment, schedules, I mean, charts that show it. But basically what we're talking about is we're talking about Lebanese and Syrian and Iranian and West African nations where Hezbollah has a strong foothold, and these individuals are extraordinarily heavily involved with the Colombian and the Mexican cartels, not only in the laundering of money, because, you know, Lebanon at one time before the wars began there, going back, you know, way back, was a huge money laundering center, still is a big money laundering center, but it was a resort country,
and
it was a money, it was kind of like the Grand Caymans of the Middle East. And there are a large number of people.
It's often called the Paris of the Middle East.
It could be the Paris of the Middle East too, but I know that they had tremendous bank secrecy. There's no transparency with respect to banks and bank account transactions in Lebanon to this very day. The Western world can't get access to that type of information. But the Lebanese, for many, many, many decades, have been extraordinarily. You know, they're just very effective, big business businessmen. They're merchants. And they've established themselves around the globe in free trade zones around the world, whether it's the Colón free trade zone in Panama or Maicao in Colombia or the free trade zones of West Africa. But in this particular case now, really, because of the fact that they recognize how profitable the drug world is, they started off first just providing money laundering services to the cartels. Then they got much more involved with them in helping them to transship drugs and money around the world. Some people don't recognize that the checkerboard for the movement of drugs, it doesn't just go from South America through Mexico and Central America into North America. There's a separate route that goes from Venezuela, because the Venezuelan government will not allow any Western law enforcement presence, and they have harbored in the past members of FARC, the leftist guerrilla terrorist organization that's also very much involved in drug trafficking that's based in Colombia. They've harbored, given them safe harbor there. But and Venezuela has a very, very strong relationship with Iran, with Syria, with Lebanon. And so therefore it's a very natural thing for the Colombian and Mexican cartels to use Venezuela as a springboard, then to go to nations in West Africa like Guinea-Bissau, Mali, Ghana, Benin. All of these nations have been corrupted by the Colombian and Mexican cartels. About 10 days ago, the former head of the Navy for Guinea-Bissau and the former head of the military there, they only caught one of them. They caught the guy who used to be the head of the Navy, to be the head of the Army, wound up getting away. But the DEA did an operation in international waters and lured them to a boat where there was supposed to be a meeting with members of FARC. And so that guy, the former head of the Navy there, is now in a courtroom in New York facing prosecution for drug trafficking and money laundering.
They haven't read him his rights yet?
Oh, yeah, there's no doubt about that. They read him his rights right after they extranapped him out of international waters. But you know what the cartels have done is they've gone to these nations which have suffered. The people of those nations have suffered terribly at the hands of the leadership there through the pilfering of their treasuries. So much goodwill and money is sent to those nations in an effort to try to do something to help the poor. But unfortunately, that gets ripped off by the leaders of their country in many instances. And now those corrupt leaders are working closely with the Colombian and Mexican cartels, giving free passage in their nation for the movement of literally tens of tons of cocaine at a time. And it goes through those West African nations and ultimately up into Europe, and that's where that market and that cycle goes to. And the money that's collected in West Africa, in the West African nations, is physically couriered to Ghana that has good commercial flights between them and Lebanon. And that money goes to Lebanon into the banks that offer no transparency whatsoever to the Western world, and the Lebanese are extraordinarily involved in the in not just the laundering, but they've now been paid in cocaine, so they distribute in Africa, in the Middle East, and up into Europe part of that product. But the Juma case is a clear example of that, and there have been other cases that have shown a lot of people don't recognize there are more Lebanese in South America than there are in Lebanon. There are 8 million individuals who have migrated into South America and now into Central America as well. And many of these people, are very, very supportive of Hezbollah. You know, I gave a talk in France about a year ago, and some of the people in the audience were businessmen from West African nations. And it wasn't until after I spoke that the person who, because I had been talking about the Juma case and the involvement of Hezbollah, and as the person who I was there, who had hosted me there, said, you know, one man's terrorist is another man's freedom fighter. So I have a feeling that in some respects, my message wasn't received very well by some of those people in the West African nations.
It's true.
So, it's absolutely true. But there are cases that show not only in the Juma case the movement of drugs, but we have other cases that show arms dealing with Hezbollah. There's, I mean, I can name the cases, but the easiest thing for someone to do, to find all of this information, because it's all very documented and detailed, would be to go to, on your just go to the web and Google a report. It's called A Line in the Sand, and it's actually a congressional subcommittee report. Congressman McCall out of Texas is the chairman of that subcommittee, and he detailed in that report this very present danger of the involvement of Hezbollah, naming the cases, naming who did what and when. So you can look at not just the drug trafficking cases, but the arms dealing cases as well.
Gee, that's incredible. But we haven't heard anything about that because we have a president who refuses to use the word terrorist, who refuses to talk about radical Islam, and who refuses to admit that he's a Muslim, even though he said, I'm one of you, even though he said, I've been to the 57 states. The only reference I know to 57 states are the 57 or 56 states of Islam. Hello.
Well, I have always been scratching my head here about why this report that came out I think it was in November of 2012, why this report didn't get a lot of traction in the media, didn't get a lot of traction outside of this subcommittee. For some strange reason, not too many people seem to be aware of the existence of it. And it's definitely worth a very, very close read.
Bob?
Yeah, I'm here now. I lost you for a minute.
No, you didn't lose me. I just screened the caller. I'm going to put him on. Caller, you have a question?
Well, I just caught your show kind of late, but it sounds an awful lot to me like the two things that are happening right now is conservatives are beating the war drums while simultaneously wanting to pass amnesty for illegals. So how can I take anybody's, the idea of anybody taking terrorism seriously when they want to secure the borders and when most Republicans, especially the most hawkish ones, seem like they want to give amnesty to illegals and we still don't have an entry-exit visa system set up. And what's the idea here that, you know, we're not being tough on terrorism, so we should go to war with another country in the Middle East? I mean, what's the...
Good question. Bob, I was going to ask you those, so let's get to them now.
Okay. Another thing that I think is very important that's in A Line in the Sand is the testimony that was given by Janet Napolitano, and it's summarized in that report, and it's admission to the fact that the U.S. government controls... can only say that they control roughly 44% of the border. And so your caller is right in my view that unless and until we have a secure border, we can't even begin to try to deal with the risk.
But Janet Napolitano said that, I mean, she stands there and she lies about the security of the border. They take a Senate delegation to the southern border, and, you know, they always take these congressional delegations to the best spots. They never see the worst of anything. So they're standing there talking about how secure the border is, and people start climbing over the fence.
Well, you know, I don't understand how anybody can suggest that the border is secure and some of the facts.
But she does.
Some of the facts that are in this congressional report are that since 2007, there have been 13 Border Patrol agents that have been killed along that border, that during 2010, 2011, we have 22 murders, 24 assaults, 15 shootings, 5 kidnappings in Texas alone that are directly linked to the cartel, so the violence is spilling over to this side. Since 2004, we've had 138 arrests or indictments for corruption within our own Border Patrol resources. The problems that are along that border are unbelievable, and even the Border Patrol agents have testified about the fact that they truly are out-resourced by the cartels. Their seized radio equipment from drug traffickers is more sophisticated than most of the radio equipment that's being used by our Border Patrol agents who are there. We can't even tell when we have people that go out because of the terrain being so so severe that we can't get repeaters that can see one another, so we're not able to really be able to get people to all be able to talk to one another along the border. And we've had incidences where we've had Border Patrol agents shooting at Border Patrol agents because they don't know their other Border Patrol agents. So, you know, to suggest that the border is secure is ridiculous. Now, the other comment about going to war, you know, I'm not suggesting that. My hope for trying to speak about the very heavy involvement of Hezbollah in the drug trafficking and money laundering activities is to try to help the American public get their eyes opened to the clear and present danger that we have across that border, because these factions of Hezbollah that are involved now with the drug cartels control, if you take the time to look at the Juma case, they control global businesses that move containers all over the world. Now, it doesn't take a lot to go from moving drugs to moving hazardous materials. And I think that while we've been focused on two wars in the Middle East,
right,
this war has been brewing within the drug world and be getting bigger and bigger every single day. And unless and until we secure the border, we're not even going to begin to be able to deal with it. And so my whole message,
but
my
Janet
message
Napolitano,
is,
but Robert, Janet Napolitano has said our borders are secure and we need to start amnesty. We need to start our immigration reform policy immediately.
Well, if you take a look at this, we sell in the United States. There's roughly. And the estimates have come out through studies that were done by many different groups, but including United Nations on Drugs and Crime. The amount of cash generated in the United States from the sale of illegal drugs probably is somewhere in the range of the low numbers were in the 30s, the high numbers were in the $60 billion a year. Let's just say it's $30 billion a year. Now, we all know that the majority of the currency that is smuggled out of the country, that's generated from drug trafficking, is smuggled out of the country south through Mexico into other nations. Janet Napolitano, in just the last couple of weeks, came out kind of very proudly to say that the Border Patrol had seized during the last year $150 million in currency. Well, you compare $150 million to 30-some billion, and that tells you about how effective we are on being able to stop the exodus of this illegal financial empire that is built in this country every year. It's
all right.
Ridiculous.
Well, look, Bob, we got about 30 seconds here. Can you leave our audience with something they can look up?
Something they can look up. Yes, yeah, they can look up about my book if you'd like to do
okay.
that. Okay, there's a website for my book, which is the-infiltrator.com. That's the-infiltrator.com. The book basically tries to bring you inside the cartel where I lived and worked for a total of 5 years and helps you to understand how the international banking and business community caters to them in the laundering of their drug proceeds.
Okay. Well, thanks again. And where can they get the book? Amazon?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, if you go on the-infiltrator.com, you'll see where to buy tab. You click that, it'll give you a direct link to Amazon.com, Borders, all the major book distributors that are carrying the book.
Okay. Well, thanks again. Thanks for being with us, Bob Muzar.
It's my pleasure. Thank you.
Okay. Bob Muzar, great
Hi,
American.
I'm Tom Sudeikis, President and CEO of Precision Payroll of America. We're the 29-year-old company whose first employee and first client are still working together. With me today is one of my favorite nonprofit clients.
Thanks, Tom. I'm Ray McElroy, chaplain of the Chicago Bears, former NFL defensive back, and founder of the Area Hope on Earth organization. At the heart of success is a hardworking, dedicated team. That's what I found at Precision Payroll. Tom and his team have simplified my payroll, tax, and HR challenges so I can focus all of my energy on the hard work at hand. A Ray of Hope on Earth brings opportunity, empowerment, and hope to scores of children in need. Use my number one play in my playbook and call Precision Payroll of America today.
Thanks, Ray. You're my hero. To join our growing team of winners, call me at 630-242-1507. That's 630-242-1507.
1507 or on the web at precisionpayroll.com.
Hi, if you want to know what's going on in the state of Illinois, in the city of Chicago, as well as what's happening in Washington, D.C., please go to championnews.net. That's championnews with two N's, .net. Or you can listen to Champion News Talk Radio every Sunday at 8 a.m. on AM 560 WIND. That's every Sunday at 8 a.m. on AM 560 WIND.
Hi, this is Charles Butler, managing partner of Arisint. We make our clients informed decision makers. Please call us for a year-end tax saving strategy. You can contact us at 312-612-1009.
That you know the routine, folks. You are calling and we appreciate it. Arisint Financial. Hey, look, I have a great guest on with me today, Mr. Jeff Stier, who is a senior fellow at the National Center for Public Policy. I'm sorry, National Center for Public Policy Research, NCRR, PPR. Well, I'm blowing that today. But Jeff, welcome to The Take with Charles Butler. It has been a long day.
Hey, Charles,
day,
it's an honor
friend.
To be with you.
Well, it's always great. Always great having you back. Hey, look, you did something with Pfizer that I have not seen anyone do. And how do you get the guts, the moxie to go out and do these things? Explain to our guests what happened, first of all. I mean, our host, what happened, first of all.
Well, yesterday I spoke at the Pfizer annual shareholder meeting, and I challenged the CEO of Pfizer to stand up to the federal government, which is sending in representatives, government-paid representatives, to go into your doctor's office and try to persuade them to prescribe different medications. You know, for a long time, pharmaceutical companies have been sending in what they call drug detailers, pharmaceutical reps, to go into doctors' offices and say, hey, we think you ought to buy this medicine. Certainly it's the medicine that drug company makes. And obviously there's a conflict of interest there, and the way we deal with that, and we balance the right of a company to market their product with the inherent conflict of interest, especially on such a sensitive issue as medicine, those communications are both highly regulated and must be transparent. So when a drug detailer goes into a doctor's office, everything they say has to be approved and it has to be transparent. The government has to know what they said in that meeting. Now, we've got the federal government sending public relations firms, consultants, into doctor's offices trying to persuade them to prescribe generic medicines, less expensive medicines. And look, Charles, you and I are both in favor of the government spending less money, so that's always a good thing. But
right.
The way they're doing this, because obviously there is an inherent conflict of interest in government detailers, just like drug pharmaceutical company detailers, whereas in the government detailers, they're trying to prescribe generic as opposed to the pharmaceutical companies are trying to prescribe the branded medication, there's the same conflict of interest, and therefore we believe that those communications between the detailer and the physician, whether they're done by the company or done by the federal government, ought to be, number one, regulated and approved, and number two, transparent. And that's to deal with this inherent conflict of interest. And there's no reason that the federal government is immune from conflicts of interest. They could do it just as badly as pharmaceutical companies, and that's why we're in favor of regulation of pharmaceutical companies in a reasonable way to govern these communications. And similarly, the federal government ought to be subject to that. And until now, this goes back to the 2009 stimulus bill. Those communications, and they're increasing dramatically. The amount of dollars the federal government is spending on these so-called drug detailers, pharmaceutical academic detailers, really government detailers, is increasing exponentially over the next few years. So we have urged Congress to take a look at this law that permits the government to send representatives into doctors' offices and shut it down. And if they don't shut it down, at least make it regulated and transparent. And what happened yesterday is I challenged the CEO of Pfizer in public at the shareholder meeting as a shareholder to challenge the government to do the same. And this is a company, Pfizer, who spent shareholder company money to lobby for Obamacare, they have done a dramatic about-face. And now they are trying to persuade Congress to defund this program, to require at the very least that it be transparent. He said that his company's position is 100% square with that of the National Center, that this program must end, and if it doesn't end, it must at least be regulated and transparent. And that, you know, I applaud Pfizer for such a drastic turnaround.
Well, what they found, it must have found it was going to harm their business, because they don't do anything out of the goodness of their heart.
Fair enough. Fair enough. Nor should they. They're private sector, and the way we have innovation in this country, the way we have life-saving drugs,
I guess
so
they figured that 3%, that 3% was going to kill them, right?
Well,
cut into that profit,
you know,
margin.
To the extent that a private sector will lobby the government to stay out of our private practices, I'm all for it, even if it's for profit. And let me say, Charles, when industry lobbies government for more money to help that industry, we're opposed to it. We think government ought to be smaller, and there ought to be less role of government and more private sector in this country. And when those coincide, when big government and big companies coincide, we oppose it. And when the limited government view, limited regulation view, coincides with industry making more money, we're fine with
right.
that. We wish industry would stand up for free market principles, regardless of how it affected their bottom line. But you're right. You're right. They only do it when it's in their bottom line best interest. But you know what? We'll take it when we can get it.
I understand that. I do understand that, my friend. Hey, but look, it's interesting, though, that he didn't kick you out.
Well, that sometimes happens when you get a question that that is, you know, cutting edge and challenging to a CEO. Sometimes they don't answer the question. Sometimes you don't even get to ask them. It happened to a colleague of mine yesterday. But you know what? This question with Pfizer, even though I put him on the spot to have the company do a complete about-face from their previous position in supporting more government involvement in healthcare, we applaud them, at least on this occasion, for calling for a limited government. But I think the warning is out there that companies, especially pharmaceutical companies, that try to get government to do their bidding, we will stand up to them. And when they do the right thing, we will publicly applaud them, as I'm doing right here. But when they go the other way, when they support Obamacare, when they support bigger government, we as shareholders will call them on it and say, hey, you represent me. We don't want our company profiting off of taxpayers. We want our company being innovative and making a profit because consumers choose to buy it.
But realistically, and I don't have to tell you this. I mean, you know just as well as I do that the second people that after the Mr. Obama, the first people that Mr. Obama met with after he was inaugurated was the health insurance people. The second group of people he met with was Parma. So, you know, who represents Pfizer.
Yeah. Oh, you're 100% right. And the president is leaning on industry to support his agenda, which is why
they're not feeling it, are they?
Well, I think they are feeling it, but they need to feel.
Feeling his position or supporting his position.
Oh, you're right.
Is what
they,
I meant.
They are recognizing that maybe this is not good for their bottom line. And
I think more importantly, they're taking a beating at home. I'm sure the kids are coming home because at the end of the day, these people are people too. You know, their kids are coming home and say, you know, hey, Dad, what are you doing? What are you going to do? What if Grandma was one of your employees, you know?
Yeah.
What if
why
I was one of your employees?
Yep. That's exactly why we're doing what we're doing. We need to pressure industry, just like the left does, to make the right choices. And if we don't pressure them, then they're going to be subject to the pressure of the president inviting them into the White House. We can't invite them into the White House for a private meeting. We can go out into their shareholder meetings and ask tough questions and challenge them.
Man. Well, that's what you're supposed to do. It's a great strategy.
Thank you.
And and it takes a lot of guts to do this. You know, you can't be a lightweight standing up to these guys and dealing with issues
security.
That you deal with, man.
There's
yeah.
security, so he's walking right out.
Yeah.
You
got to
ask the questions. And we represent, and Charles, you know this, we represent hundreds of thousands of Americans who share our point of views on these issues. These people are at work every day doing their job. We're going out representing them.
Well, you know, and we appreciate that. You know, I certainly do. You know, I take a beating here doing what I do. But it's all good because at the end of the day, we need to stay on the we need to stay on top of the companies. We need to stay on top of these decision makers because
exactly.
they need to hear another side. They need
That's
to hear
exactly
another side.
Right.
You know, they
exactly
don't always hear. You know, they hear from the policy wonks. They hear from the corporate types. They don't hear from the people.
That's
and
exactly
when they,
why we do that.
And when you guys get there, you talk about this from a humanistic personal side.
Absolutely. We use good policy making. We use science. Absolutely. We try to bring it down to the personal level so the industry could understand why we believe in, and we think it's in the company's best interest to represent and to advance smaller government, limited regulation, less government involvement in our healthcare. And that's what we're going to continuing fighting for, and I appreciate the opportunity to share it with your huge audience.
Well, you know, it's we do what we do here from the take with Charles Butler, but you know, it's what amazes me is that Fox News and none of these other so-called conservative outlets pick up on what you're doing.
Well, we put the message out. It's up to others whether they listen. But as you know, I'm a regular guest on CNBC, so it's nice to be reaching out to different audiences. Fox News will sooner or later come back on board and recognize that the public needs to hear this side of the story.
Well, do you talk about what you did at Pfizer on CNBC?
You know, that's an interesting question. I probably should have pitched it to them, but did not get to that one.
Okay.
But it'll come up.
Because
it'll come up. In
now,
the
do
future.
You do you advertise? Do you come on at the same time on CNBC, or do you just do guest?
Oh, it's
guest
different
spots?
Shows. Yeah, they invite me on to when there's breaking news, they'll call and say, hey, we'd appreciate your commentary on the issue, just like as I occasionally get to join your show, but it's not a regular slot.
Okay, because I was just wondering if there was a regular time we could go catch you, because other than that, you just have to send out something that says, hey, guys, here I am.
There you go. Well, you could follow me on Twitter, Jeff, J-E-F-F. My middle initial is A, and my last name is Stier, S as in Sam, T-I-E-R. So Jeff A. Stier on Twitter, and I'll always put it out there when I'm going to do a show, that your listeners can follow me on Twitter at Jeff A. Stier, S-T-I-E-R. And I'll let you all know.
Well, that'd be great. That would be great because I would love to catch you because you are such a wealth of information. And
I appreciate the opportunity.
You know, so what do you have on the horizon coming up?
Oh, well, we're working on so many issues. Right now, one of the pieces that we're working on is how the Environmental Working Group, one of the left-wing environmental activist groups, is trying to scare people from doing the healthy thing to eat more fruits and vegetables by saying that we should only eat organic fruits and vegetables. That's a bad idea. They put out a
totally bad idea.
We want more Americans eating more fruits and vegetables, and they put out this list that they shamefully call the Dirty Dozen to say that these fruits and vegetables are dirty and that they're toxic and they have toxic pesticide residue, even though the federal government obviously says we ought to be eating more fruits and vegetables, not just organic ones. So, you know, every day we're standing up to the left-wing activists who are trying to involve themselves in the government and our lives, and we're standing up for freedom.
Oh, you mean like
Michelle
Obama, who's talking about obese kids, and the kids can't go outside to play because they may get shot? You're talking about kids who are afraid to go to school because they may get shot? Hello?
Yeah. Yeah, well, these are the issues that we need to talk about. We need to put these issues into context and perspective. So that's what we do.
But we're ignored because people really don't want to deal with the facts. They really don't want to know what's going
on. That's right. They want to advance.
In a lot of cases.
That's exactly right. And the last thing I'll say before I go is they want to advance an ideology, and they don't care about public health. The ideology of the public health movement in this country is driven by left-wing big government politics, anti-corporate politics. We believe that we should take back the public health movement and use limited government, sound science, personal responsibility, individual decision making
to
help lead
us
to better
public you mean you don't want me to make a decision between having a 64-ounce soda versus a 32-ounce soda or two 32-ounce sodas?
I live in New York City. Mayor Bloomberg thinks he's got that taken care of, and we stand up to him on that.
Man, this is a guy who kills me. He's so important, he has 8 bodyguards. But he doesn't want people to have a gun to protect themselves.
His bodyguards have guns. I've seen them.
It's just amazing to me. Yep. I'm sorry, Jeff, that anyone could be that self-important.
That's exactly it.
I mean, this is a guy who – go ahead.
Yeah, no, it was a pleasure talking with you about this. I applaud you for taking on these issues as well.
Well, thank you, man. We just do what we do out here, and we work with the center, and work with Project 21, and we just try to make people informed about what's going on in their country. Hey, well, look, I know you're getting ready to get on your weekend, so enjoy your weekend, and hopefully we'll be back next week to chat a little bit.
Thank you, Charles. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
You too, Jeff. All right, bye-bye. Mr. Jeff Stagger from the National Center for Public Policy Research, just outstanding young man. And before we wrap up for the weekend, we're going to have Mr. Hughey Newsome on with us from Project 21. Hughey is a Harvard graduate, business consultant. And we're just going to kick it a little bit here in about 15 minutes. So don't go anywhere. I'm going to take a quick break, and we will be right back.
I live alone and rarely have visitors. So when I slipped and fell in the kitchen last month, and couldn't get to a phone, I knew I was in trouble.
Help!
I could barely move.
Help!
I tried calling for help, but no one could hear me. As I lay there, I couldn't help but think of my kids and grandkids having to go on without me. I was terrified. It took 8 hours for my neighbor to find me. It could have been the end of me. That's when I knew I needed Life Alert. With just one press of this button, I'm connected to the Life Alert Center, where I can get the help I need, even when I cannot reach a phone. With Life Alert, I'm never alone.
Call toll-free 1-800-869-0258 for your free Life Alert brochure. That's 1-800-869-0258. Again, 1-800-869-0258. Call for your free Life Alert brochure at 1-800-869-0258.
Hi, my name is Charles Butler, and I'm the managing partner for Arisit LLC, a financial services company with agents in 30 states to help you with your financial goals and objectives. Today, I want to talk to you about the Bonus 162 plan. Many firms are finding it harder and harder to obtain, retain, and reward key employees and executives. Using a little-known technique, employers can use special benefit options to give employees a growing cash values in the form of company-paid cash value accumulation insurance or annuity policies. While not mainstream, These saving programs and disaster coverage is an effective bonus for employees while remaining a valid business deduction for employers. Please call us to find out how you could implement one of these plans. Our number is 312-612-1009 or go to our website at www.aricentllc.com. Thank you.
Well, folks, we want to come back before I bring our next guest on to talk a little bit about the all the killing in Chicago. How many people died this week? Well, I'll be better able to tell you on Monday because Red Eye, this paper here in Chicago, they always talk about the homicides. And, man, they do such a great job. They do a better job than the police on getting this message out about the homicides. In fact, that's where I used to get a lot of my information from the Red Eye, the paper Red Eye. It's part of the Tribune. But it's, you know, they have a little slot here. It goes, you know, click here for homicides, you know. So you click on the little thing and it brings up all the homicides that have happened here in Chicago for the so far this month. We've had 21 homicides, and let's see who some of the victims are. Ooh, okay. Oh, they're a teenager. Let's see. Oh, man. I'm trying to figure out if this is a 9 or a 0. Oh, okay, 9s. All right, here we go. Okay, this person killed 426. That's today. It's this morning. Gunshot wound on the south side. Dane Whitfield, 31, killed on the south side yesterday. Excuse me. Day before yesterday. Cornelius German, 15 years old, student, killed gunshot wound, 50 East, okay, that's South Side. Ricardo Carlin, 22, he's not a student, at least he's too old to be a student, West Side. Miguel Cancel, got canceled. West Side, Jonathan Santiago killed West Side, 5-month-old Angela Rodriguez, asphyxia, boyfriend probably, Julius Campbell stabbed on property, Kidsey. What about the young man who was killed over in Barack's neighborhood? Let's see, where is that? Wouldn't be Levette, wouldn't be Dorchester. Dang, that was, come on, Charles. May not see the hundreds. Come on. 2500 Fitch, Beach, Irvin Park. Now, he was killed. Now, all of these killings aren't listed because there's a young man who was killed. Oh, here it is. Yeah, Cornelius German. I guess that's him. He was killed not too far from Barack's house yesterday. Yeah. Yep, there we go. But, you know, he was known to hang out with gangbangers. So, you know, the bottom line is sooner or later, these things happen. Horrible, just horrible. But anyway, I'm not going to dwell on that. But I tell you, man, this thing kind of gives it up, you know? So I wonder if the Obamas are coming back to town for his funeral. I doubt it. You know, they're just about politicizing and grandizing, self-grandizing on other folks. Misery. That's what these folks do these days. I could never see President Bush doing something like that, though. Never. Never. He has too much class. Hey, but look, it is almost 5 o'clock. Going to bring in my last guest, Mr. Hughey Newsome, talk about what's going on this week. So bear with us. We shall fire it up here in a minute. So we'll be right back.
Hi, I'm Tom Sedaka, President and CEO of Precision Payroll of America. We're the 29-year-old company whose first employee and first client are still working together. With me today is one of my favorite nonprofit clients.
Thanks, Tom. I'm Ray McElroy, chaplain of the Chicago Bears, former NFL defensive back, and founder of the Area Hope on Earth organization. At the heart of success is a hard-working, dedicated team. That's what I found at Precision Payroll. Tom and his team have simplified my payroll, tax, and HR challenges so I can focus all of my energy on the hard work at hand. Area Hope on Earth brings opportunity, empowerment, and hope to scores of children in need. Use my number one play in my playbook and call Precision Payroll of America today.
Thanks, Ray. You're my hero. To join our growing team of winners, call me at 630-242-1507. That's 630-242-1507 or on the web at precisionpayroll.com.
Hi, if you want to know what's going on in the state of Illinois, in the city of Chicago, as well as what's happening in Washington, D.C., please go to championnews.net. That's championnews with two N's, .net. Or you can listen to Champion News Talk Radio every Sunday at 8 a.m. on AM 560 WIND. That's every Sunday at 8 a.m. on AM 560 WIND.
Hi, this is Charles Butler, managing partner of Arison. We make our clients informed decision makers. Please call us for a year-end tax-saving strategy. You can contact us at 312-612-1009 or go to our website, ArisonLLC.com. That's ArisonLLC.com. You need to do that for your family, your business, and yourself. Don't forget to give us a call at 312-612-1009 or go to the website ArisonLLC.com. Thank you.
I can almost quit playing that song because it won't be cold outside very long. It's 60-something degrees here today, this afternoon, and I have Mr. Hughey Newsome with me. Hughey is a member of Project 21, a good friend, and we are rolling right along. So, hey, Hughey.
Yes, sir.
Can you believe Barack Obama's speech at Planned Parenthood? I mean, this guy is either he's brain dead or he's just such a hypocrite. Why is it always smoke and mirrors with Barack? I can never believe this guy because everything that he says is just the opposite of what it really is. So tell us your take on his speech at Planned Parenthood, what he said, and your take on it.
Well, you know, I think it was typical Barack Obama. He usually takes the whole idea of, you know, Planned Parenthood is for women's health. Anybody that's against Planned Parenthood is against women's health, and he demagogues. Typical Barack. But as usual, if you find, nobody talks about the lives lost through the funded abortion, particularly in the black community, from all Planned Parenthood's activity. It just never comes up.
Uh-huh. Hello?
So I was very disappointed in the speech, but I wasn't surprised.
Uh-huh. So let me ask you this, Hughey. You know, what about the how he's handling this Boston situation, the Boston bombing? You know, he has, you know, asked one of his, I'm sure the Justice Department asked that judge to go in there and Mirandize that guy. I just don't see that happening out of the clear blue.
No, I was concerned as well. I'm still not convinced, and like I was telling someone earlier, it's a question of what would you do? Would you say that you had been helped? Would you say you had been supported if you're one of the bombing brothers, if you're the surviving bombing brother? Chances are you say whatever it took to avoid being, you know, to avoid being interrogated. And that doesn't give me a large sense of safety and security right now. And that's really the top priority. But somehow this administration is focused on other things. I'm giving some interference. I don't know if that's me or you.
It's not me. I'm good over here.
Okay. All right. Well, let's keep going. But, yeah, for some reason that is not the administration's top priority. It's very concerning.
Hmm. Well, when you say concerning in what way?
Concerning in what way? What if there are other bombs sitting out there that we don't know about?
How
do we get to the bottom of
it? Obama doesn't care. They're not going to bother him. Why should he care? Why should Georgia? Well, I mean, think about it. Why should he care? Why should Biden care?
No, really they shouldn't, because no matter what happens, they'll politicize it. So, par for the course.
Yeah.
You know, it is disappointing, but the thing is, one thing that we should learn from this incident is that there still are people that are willing to do anything just to kill us, and we have to get out of this. We have to get out of this law that we've had for the past few years, because we're still under attack. And people have to understand that. There's a very real threat out there.
Well, you know, I don't think they feel they should understand it. There's nothing for them to understand in many of them's opinion.
There's a disconnect, right? There's a disconnect between what goes on inside the Beltway, which is where I am now, and
mm-hmm.
what goes on outside the Beltway. If you think about it, politicians are protected. Go back to the gun control debate. Politicians are protected. They're not on the south side of Chicago on the front lines like you are. So when they look at gun control, for instance,
right.
they look at it under security of teams of armed guards. You don't have that when you walk down the street on the south side.
They don't care.
When you are in South Central. They don't care.
But you don't get it.
Though.
They don't care.
It's all about politics. How do I get a political leg up? And that's the sad part about the debates that we have in this country. Everything is politicized. I mean, you think about it. I've yet to see a mother from the south side of Chicago get to do the presidential address, the presidential weekly address,
right.
like he allowed one of the Newtown mothers to do.
Yeah.
But
well,
behold,
you know, she had the right. She was the right persuasion.
Yes, well, you know, I can't argue against that one. But, no, I mean, it's very troubling, right, because there are real policy implications of such irresponsibility, right? So if you think
mm-hmm.
about it, if you take all the guns, we've had this discussion before, you take all the guns away from the law-abiding citizens, does that mean all the guns will disappear? What happens to the guns that are owned illegally?
He doesn't care. Barack Obama, look, a 15-year-old boy was killed two blocks from Barack Obama's house on the 22nd. That's 4 days ago. Has he said anything?
No. I was waiting for Michelle to come visit. She didn't come visit?
Yeah, well, if you don't, don't wait too long, bro, because I'm telling you, she ain't coming.
No, not coming. The only reason she came for Hadia's funeral was because Hadia was at the inauguration. Otherwise, Michelle would have just flown over for another fundraiser. But in the sad part,
well, she did do a fundraiser.
Yes, thank you for correcting me. You are correct. She did do a fundraiser. You know, and of course the Hadiyah was just a pit stop on the way to raising more money.
Right. And so, the president came through, picked up his boys, and went down to Florida to golf.
Yes, exactly. Right. So, you know, when you think about, and that's the sad part about this administration, because they play the empathy card so well. It's almost like they feel your pain, and they're going to do something about it, whether it be jobs, whether it be crime, whether it be guns, whether it be safety against terrorism. We feel your pain, but they always do something that's in the exact
opposite. Look, man, they are taking money. They are taking money out of the mouths of veterans.
Oh yeah. Absolutely.
And
which is never
and every time you see Michelle, she's, oh, the military families, they make so many sacrifices. Well, they're steady taking benefits and monies out of the veterans programs.
Well, hey, you know, it's one of those things where it's not like the media's going to talk about it. All the media's going to do is give them a megaphone. And that's the sad part about it. And that's the sad part about it, particularly considering how Americans are former vets that are starving. When you talk about vets that are struggling in poverty, and then you break it down by race, once again, just about anything else, blacks get a disproportionate feel and effect from those negative things in our society.
Well, True, Hughey, the president said he's not concerned about black people. He said that what's good for America is good for black people, and he does not have an agenda. He's the first president since George Washington not to have a black agenda.
Well, you know what? And that's funny because the first one to have such a lack of an agenda is also the same one that enjoyed above 90% voting for him in national elections. That is amazing.
Well, that's what they get. No, that's exactly
what
they get.
You get what you vote for. You get what you vote for.
And he got what we voted for. And
voted for.
See, I'm not complaining because I didn't vote for the guy.
I didn't either. But you know,
so
what?
I'm not complaining. I just sit back and laugh at these people who voted for this guy and had no idea who they were voting for. I just found that to be the most.
They knew who they were voting for. They were voting for somebody that was cool, that all the black celebrities liked, and he goes on this show and he goes on that show. But yet again, we failed in our community to have a deep, objective discussion about what policies looks like.
Oh no, they want to do that. They want to do that now after he's in his second term because they're so stupid. They're so stupid. They say, well, he couldn't do anything his first term. And you know what? I always go, how stupid are you? What makes you think that with your stupid behind? He did it for the gays. He did it for the Latinos, and he can't do anything for you. And then, but black folks, you have to remember, black people are politically and economically unsophisticated.
I hope you can read between the lines. I love the word unsophisticated. I won't use the word stupid, but it's very difficult.
See,
it's a difference between you and me.
Well, no,
I decided that today,
Hughey, I'm going to, you know, what's his name has his word, pinhead. So my word is going to be politically unsophisticated.
I can live with that.
Or economically unsophisticated or historically unsophisticated. And then it doesn't sound so harsh as to call somebody stupid. Okay? Just call people stupid. You're stupid, man.
A euphemism.
Yeah,
hey, that's
you're stupid, man. You're stupid. Okay, so I decided to ease up today just a little bit. And, you know, just keep it real, though.
Say it again.
I said, just keep it real.
Just keep it real. Let's do it, man.
Just
keep
it
real.
You know, you look at, I did a segment today on Hezbollah and the drug cartels. And it's amazing.
Uh-huh.
It's amazing, man, the connection between Hezbollah and the drug cartels. There's a report out called A Line in the Sand. It's a congressional report. It is, man, it is scathing. And nobody wants to deal with Hezbollah and the drug cartels, who are distributing drugs all in Africa now.
You know, and that's, it's, you know why I think that is? A, because nobody cares about Africa in this country. That's one problem. But the other
you mean
is,
not the African Americans? The African Americans don't care about Africa?
Of course not. I mean, you look at the last president of the United States who did so much to help AIDS, to help combat AIDS on the African continent. And
well, he finally got some credit. He finally got some credit.
Has he really gotten the credit? From who?
No,
he
got some credit when they opened his library. That's what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Hey, but look.
All the liberals lined up to bash him, including the black liberals such as your friend Al Sharpton.
What did that idiot have to say?
Oh, he basically bashed George, the whole Bush Library. MSNBC, there was a whole – everybody opened with the opening of the Bush Library saying that it's a bit of revisionist history to try to rewrite all the good things, you know, all the bad things George Bush did as good things. Of course, AIDS in Africa never came up. The fact that we
well,
did
of course not.
Have
not. Al Sharpton – Al Sharpton is about one thing, getting paid. He and Jesse both.
And
you know, if you look at the National Action Network, is a joke. Here in Chicago, we have the third largest city in the country, and National Action Network doesn't even exist.
If you go to
Action Network in New York and ask the people, are they being paid?
They're not being paid.
The other entity
is not being paid is the government because he's behind by about $400,000 on his taxes. The National Action Network is. So anybody that wants to come to me and say that Al Sharpton has any level, and of course I'm sorry because I took you off topic, but anybody that wants to say that Al Sharpton has any level of credibility enough to have five people listen to him talk at the local community center. Forget it. But how on earth does he get his own network? So when MSNBC goes around and says Republican racist, they have a black person to codify that. That's basically all Al Sharpton's job is.
Well, this is a guy who can't even read. He can't read a teleprompter.
Oh my! But again,
this is a guy who never went to college.
Right. I thought I was the only one that knows that he literally cannot read a teleprompter. It is painful to listen to his show. I can't keep it on for 10 minutes. It's painful to listen to him struggle to read a teleprompter. Like it's just English. But anyway, that's such is life.
So it makes you wonder what kind of pastor, what kind of theology school or seminary school gave Al Sharpton a piece of paper.
Probably Sharpton School of Seminary.
Probably. You know, I always tease. I told this joke once, and I'm not talking about legitimate pastors who have gone to legitimate institutions. I'm talking about my friends who went to the internet or went mail order and bought those degrees, right? And, you know, you get the package, you open the package, or you open the file online, or you open the package in the mail, take open book test. Hey, take an open book test, you mail it in, they send you back a certificate, say, doctor, Reverend Dr. Charles Butler. So I want, and I told this, I told people, yeah, exactly, thank you. I told these people on my show, I want you to call me. When you call in here, you address me as Reverend Dr. Charles Butler. And I mean no offense to you legitimate Reverend Doctors out there, but this here is the Reverend Dr. Charles Butler of the VON Southside Exclusionary Church. And, man, people called in. They said, man, I was laughing so hard I had to pull over to the side of the road.
That's hilarious.
And then, man, people called in. They were like, Charles, I was laughing so hard I had to pull over, man. It's bad, man.
No,
I'm bad, man.
No, I can see why, man. That's pretty good.
I was, you know. Hey, but Hughey, I know that you gotta shove off, man. You got another interview to get ready for, and you know, what do you wanna leave our audience with today?
You know, I'm actually doing a show with a liberal today, and so I've been preparing, and I'm kind of looking at all the articles and things that the liberals quote unquote care about.
Mm-hmm.
And one thing I want to close with is let's say that the phrase for today is circular reasoning. You know what circular reasoning is, right, Charles? Dr. Reverend Charles,
mm-hmm.
You know what circular
reasoning
is.
Yes, I do.
So here you have all these liberals. You know, Dianne Feinstein, just look. Dianne Feinstein came out this week with a demand that the administration go ahead and release the 86 prisoners left in Guantanamo Bay. She said that the living conditions are atrocious and, you know, they're rebelling. They're gonna. This is Senator Dianne Feinstein of California.
Oh, that idiot.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Another idiot.
So here's the funny part. You have all these liberals running around worshiping Barack Obama. And which is it? He can't close prison? Or are you going to admit that there's a terrorist over there? And that it's ridiculous.
No, let them out. Let them out. Send them right to San Francisco and right to Washington, D.C. to blow her ass up.
Well, as long just make sure I'm not working that day and I'm outside.
Send them to the Hill. Send them to the Hill with all those morons up there. And send them over to the Justice Department with Eric Holder so they can blow his ass up, too. You know, they want to let these terrorists out into the public. Out on the American people, talking about their rights. These people are absolutely insane, you know. And you know what? They should get what they deserve. Put the terrorists in their backyards. Then they have a different attitude. You know, I think Whitney Young said it best. He said, liberalism seems to be related to a person's distance from the problem.
Yes.
That's a Dianne Feinstein, that's a Barack Obama, that's Dick Durbin, that's a Bloomberg, that's a Ted Kennedy. These people have no idea what's going on. Let the terrorists come into their – see, Dianne Feinstein, like Barack Obama and the rest, are hypocrites.
Yes.
You know, Dianne Feinstein thinks she can carry a gun because she was threatened, but the rest of us shouldn't be able to carry guns because your life isn't that important. I was threatened by a vice lord enforcer and other ex-felons, and we have them on tape. Now, I'm supposed to call 911 when I walk into a parking lot in the middle of the night? That's how stupid these people are. I have no respect for them. I have no respect for them. And because they do not care for the safety of the American people. And until they care, I could care less that they sit in Washington, D.C. I could care less that they have S-E-N-A-T-O-R in front of their name or P-R-E-S-I-D-E-N. They are people. They are no one special.
No.
And they're sent there to represent the people, not represent themselves, Hughey.
Let me go a step further and remind you, not only are they people, but they're also your employees, your taxpayers.
That's my point. They're sitting there to represent us.
And
they're not doing it.
Right, exactly.
I'm tired of hearing from people like Dianne Feinstein, who talks about, oh, we need more women in the Senate. No, we need more men in the Senate with some gonads to put these women in their place who don't know they're behind from a hole in the ground when it comes to talking about issues of importance. You meet force force. You don't meet force with compromise. You meet force with force. And if there's anyone forceful, it is the United States of America. These women need to get out of men's business. Women in combat. How stupid is that? These women have never had to do a number two in a bag held for them by another person. They just talk. All they do is sit there and talk and pontificate about movies and Star Wars, and they have no idea what reality is. And it just really sends me off into a rant that I'm not going to go on with any longer.
Well, I appreciate your passion. I appreciate your passion. And obviously, you know, I have a lot of respect for you. But, yeah, that's the closing thought for today. I guess you had not heard that, but you'll probably hear more about that as the weekend goes along. But it infuriated me, and I see that you have the same reaction.
Well, yeah, I'm looking at it right here. It's a New York Times article. It says Senator urges transfer of Gitmo detainees to Yemen. And Yemen said they don't want them. What's wrong with you, stupid Feinstein? That's what I'm going to start calling her, stupid Dianne Feinstein. Yemen has said they did not want these terrorists. And when they get the terrorists, they let them go right to terrorist camps.
Yes. So what our good friend Senator Feinstein should do, since they can't go to Yemen, they clearly can't be released into the United States. Let them go into the Feinstein mansion.
Let them go into the Senate. Let them go into DOJ. That's where I want them. I want them right there with Eric Holder, Dianne Feinstein, and Barack Obama. That's where I want those people that are detained in Gitmo to be. Because, see, they're just like all these other liberals. Oh, all these blacks are in prison because they're black. And the system, hey, they're in prison because they did something to deserve to be in prison, besides drugs. Besides drugs. See, I have a problem with blacks or whites that are in prison because of drug-related incidents if it's not related to violence. If it's related to violence, over.
Lock them up.
But I'm reading this book right now because I got to get ready for this chick next week. Michelle Alexander, I'm going to wear her behind out. She wrote a book called The New Jim Crow.
Oh, God, okay.
It's such a crock. But anyway, Hughey, as usual, man, it's been a great week, and it's great talking to you, as usual.
Yeah, the pleasure's all mine, sir. The pleasure's all mine.
And I hope to do this again with you next week, sir.
Sounds good. Sounds like a plan. You know where to find me.
Well, look, where are you going to be tonight? What show are you going to be on?
Tom Hartman's show. He's on he's on the internet, and he's also on you can find it. Yeah, you can find him on the internet. He has his show on. You should be on about 8:30 on the internet. Just Google him and go to his internet channel.
I am. Yeah, number one progressive radio show.
Yeah, you might be able to catch him. You might be able to catch him on.
I got it right here. I got it. I got him. Well, you go get him, baby.
I'm gonna
tell Tom to call and listen. If you want to listen to real radio, to listen to the tape with Charles Butler and Hughey Newsome.
I will let him know.
All right, man.
All right,
have
bro,
a good one.
Talk to you later, man.
All right, baby. Bye-bye. Good luck. All right, bye-bye. This is Hughey Newsome, my good buddy, my good friend, great American. Look, folks, we have come to the end of another week, and I want to say thank you for listening in. Thank you for your support. Thank you for your emails. Linda, I got yours. I hope you got my response. And we are going to leave with a little Diana Krall, because, you know, I love this song, but let's do this. Have a good weekend.
I have a feeling, it's a feeling I'm concealing, I don't know why. It's just a mental, sentimental alibi. But I adore you so strong for you. Why go on stalling? I am falling. My love is calling, why be shy? Let's fall in love, why shouldn't we?